everyone and welcome to another Peaky Boardgamer episode. My name is Hectorakos and in today's video I'm gonna be teaching you how to play Freedom. Freedom is a two-player siege wargame with a historical background that takes us back to the Greek Independence War. Freedom is designed by Vangelis, Bagiartakis and was brought to us earlier this year by Phalanx. Enough with talking, let's move to our board gaming table and see the rules. Freedom takes us back to April 1825 during the Greek War of Independence. The game simulates the third siege of the city of Messolonghi, which lasted a year. One player controls the Imperial forces and is trying to capture the city, while the other player takes the role of the insurgent citizens of Messolonghi, trying to withstand the attack. The board is split into two sections. The lower section depicts the city of Messolonghi and its surrounding area, as well as three important islands that played a significant role. In the top part of the board we see the greater region depicting some cities that were of great importance as well. While players mainly struggle in the city of Messolonghi, they will also be trying to support the cities in the greater area, because this will give them bonuses or resources if you like, that will help them endure the main fight in Messolonghi. At first, place the board between the two players. In the bottom part, we see that the map is organized in rows of spaces in which players will be moving their pieces. In the center we have the city of Messolonghi, and then around it we have row 1, which is the coast, row 2, which is the beach, row 3 containing the walls of the city, and then row 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8, which is the mainland. These rows will be used from the Imperial player to approach and attack the city. The red cubes are the main units that are used from the Imperial player. In the graphics, I'm showing you the number of units and the exact locations that will be used from the Imperial player during the setup. The big area in the top right corner of this map is regarded to be the camp of the Imperial forces. During setup, the Imperial player will place 5 of his units in his camp. These black pyramids are not units but cannons. The Imperial player starts with 1 cannon in the camp, and 1 more cannon in these two areas. The blue cubes are the insurgent units. The player starts with 12 of these, which are placed in the exact locations that I'm showing you again in my graphics. The insurgent player starts the game with 4 cannons, which are placed to the locations that I'm showing you. The purple pyramid is a special bombard cannon used by the insurgent player. It is more powerful than the others, and there is only 1 in the game. The player places it in this location. The white cubes are not units but citizens of Messolonghi. The insurgent player starts the game with 8 cubes in the city. Citizens can only exist in the city of Messolonghi and no other piece may ever be placed in the city. Place the rest of the cubes and the cannons in a supply next to the board. The green cubes are allies to the Imperial forces and will appear in the second period, so at the start, place them as a supply next to the board as well. Place the 8 area tiles to the corresponding spaces. They should be placed with the side that depicts a number facing upwards. These are support markers and they are double-sided. Place the indicated number of support markers onto each tile with the same colored side up as the tile's color. Place the rest of the support markers as a supply next to the board. This is the round marker and you must place it on round 1. These two tracks are used to track the morale of players, so you should place these markers on the indicated spaces on the board. These here are the preparation tracks, and both players start with 0 points. These are the plea and pressure tracks, and again, they should place one of their markers to the 0 space. Finally, this is the population track for the insurgent player, and he should set it to population 16 to 20 by placing this little marker to the corresponding space. Create a supply with the money, the supply tokens, and the destruction markers of the game. Place the set of dice near the players. The Imperial player starts the game with 10 money and 12 supplies, while the Insurgent player starts the game with just 8 supplies. Split the cards of the game according to the letter depicted in the bottom left corner of each card. A cards are used for the first period, while B cards will be used for the second period. Then deal each player 8 cards from the first period deck. The game is now ready to start. The game is played over 6 rounds, split in 2 periods of 3 rounds each, period A and period B, and each period uses its own deck of cards. Each round consists of several phases, with the main one being the action phase. The city of Messolonghi is surrounded by row number 2, which is the beach, and row number 3, which is the north wall. In the north wall, there are 4 spaces that are of great importance and are called forts. If at the end of any round's action phase, the Imperial player manages to set foot in any one of the 4 forts, even with a single unit, or set foot in any space of the beach, then he is automatically declared the winner. To enter a fort and any other space at the wall in general, the Imperial player must first destroy the wall, mainly by bombarding it with some cannons. To reach the beach, the Imperial player must set sail from the sides of the map, capture at least one island, which will give them access to the coast and then eventually to the beach. The Imperial player will also win if he manages to drop the Insurgent player's morale to 0. For the Insurgent player, time is on their side, and they will win the game if at the end of the 6th round they manage not to allow the Imperial player to capture one of the important spaces on the map. The Insurgent player also may instantly win if he drops the Imperial player's morale to 0. So let's move to gameplay. Each round consists of 5 phases, which you can see them here. Administration is a preparation phase for the next round, so skip this phase in the first round. In this phase, we simply move the round marker one space to the right, and each player refills their hands back to 8 cards using the card deck from the current period. This means that when we move to round 4, we need to switch to second period cards. In this case, if players have any first period cards, they discard them, we set aside the first period cards, and then players receive 8 new cards from the second period deck. Also remember that when we move to round 5 and round 6, the Imperial player loses 1 morale, and there is an illustration here that reminds you of this. In the opening phase, both players receive some free moves. Starting with Imperials, the player may choose any 5 units, not cannons, in the mainland and forward them one space towards Messolonghi. These moves have to be done in the mainland and not to spaces that require slow movement. For example, to climb a destroyed wall requires slow movement, so you cannot do this in the opening phase. Keep in mind that you cannot move sideways nor backwards except if you are moving from the camp. And finally, whenever players move to a space on the map, they can never exceed its limit. There are different space limits on the map, so let's talk about limits. Spaces in rows 1, 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8 have a limit of 3 units. We don't count the cannons. Cannons are not units. The only exception is the camp. There is no limit of units in the camp. Likewise, there is no limit in citizens that can exist in Messolonghi. On the island spaces, there is a limit of just 1 unit. Some of the spaces surrounding the islands have illustrations on them regarding their unit limits. For example, here, in this space, there can be only 1 unit. If, however, there is no such illustration on the space, the limit is 3 units. All spaces in rows 2 or 3 have a limit of 2 units. Now for the cannons. On a space, there can only be 1 cannon, except for the camp. And finally, you should note that there can never be Insurgent and Imperial units together on a space. Let's make a quick example of Imperial opening. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. After the Imperials, the Insurgents regroup. Regrouping is an action that we will see in the action phase, but during the opening, the Insurgents get a free regroup. When the player regroups, he moves any one of his units to any space of row 2, 3 or the islands, respecting the limits. So, for example, the player could do this, or this, or this. In the action phase, players alternate turns, playing a card from their hand, executing various actions. So that's a good point to talk a little bit about cards. All cards have a value on the top left, which is their action points, and these points can be used to execute various actions, which I will explain in a little bit. Also, all cards subscribe an event. If the flag beneath the value is blue, then this event favors the Insurgents and can only be executed by them. If the flag is red, then the event favors the Imperials and can only be executed by them. And if the flag is grey, then the event is neutral and can be executed by both players. On his turn, the player must play one of his cards. If he chooses to play a card that is beneficial to his faction or a neutral card, then he can choose to execute the card's event or use the card's action points to execute any combination of actions. But if the player plays an opponent's event, he may only use it for its action points and not for the event. After the player finishes with his turn, he places the chosen card to a discard pile, and now it is the next player's turn. If he chose to play an opponent's card though, now his opponent has the opportunity to execute his event as his next turn just by discarding any one of his cards. And if he discards a card containing his opponent's event for this reason, his opponent does not have the opportunity to do the same for his next turn. Alternatively, the player may ignore this opportunity and just play normally. The player that has the highest morale value at the start of the action phase takes the first turn and plays the first card. In case of a tie, the Imperial player starts first. The Imperials and the Insurgents have a different set of actions to choose from when they use a card for its action points. Keep in mind that players may use their action points selecting different actions or the same action multiple times. I'll start with Imperial actions first. Standard movement is an action that enables the Imperial player to move his units around the map, not cannons. Cannons don't move in general. It costs one action point and the player may either select one of his units and move them two spaces away or two of his units and move them one space away. Units may move sideways this time, but never backwards, and the player may also choose to move units from his camp to any adjacent space. Units may also move through spaces that have reached the unit limit. The player, of course, may only move to areas that do not contain enemy units. There are spaces on the map that it is harder for units to move on. These are all spaces of rows 1, 2, 3, the islands and all their surrounding areas. To move on these spaces, the player must perform the slow movement action. Again, it costs one action point, but the player may do just a single movement. To move in the sea, the Imperial player uses those blue navigation lines that link the islands and the coast. The entrance points are those three areas. So if the Imperial player has a unit here, he may perform a slow movement to move to this area here. Then he may perform a second slow movement and either move to the other island using this navigation line or move closer to the island that he's currently on. These thicker lines prohibit the Imperial forces to move from these two areas straight to this one. This limitation is lifted only when the Imperial player has a unit on the island. So the normal route would be to move first with a slow movement action to this area, get rid of this opponent unit somehow, another slow movement to go on the island, and now this limitation is lifted, these gates are open now, and other units may move straight from these areas to this one, and now the player could move this unit to any one of these three spaces by performing another slow movement as well. To move an Imperial unit on any space of row 3, which is the wall space must first be destroyed. If the wall is destroyed and there are no enemy units, as always, the player may perform a slow movement and go on top of the wall. Enemy cannons are not a problem. Players may move their units on spaces containing enemy cannons. If, however, units are on the wall, they may move to adjacent wall spaces, again by performing a slow movement, even without them being destroyed. Of course, they must be empty of enemy units. With the attack action, the player spends one action point in an attempt to destroy one enemy unit. The enemy unit must be in an adjacent space, and each one of our units may attack only once on its action turn. So if a player had three action points, he could spend only two of them to do attacks from this area. Attacks can be made from the mainland or from lagoon spaces as well. After the player specifies the target of his attack, he rolls 2d8 dice and checks each die result independently. If one or both dice have a result of 8 or more, then the attack is successful and the enemy unit is removed from the board. Otherwise, nothing happens. If the last unit in the area is removed, then the attacker may either increase his morale or decrease the opponent's morale by 1 point. Of course, there are some modifiers to these rolls. all wall spaces of row 3 may either be damaged, offering a plus 1 modifier to each die, or they can be destroyed, offering a plus 2 modifier. Attacking a fourth space gives a minus 1 modifier to each die. However, if the attack is made from inside the wall to an adjacent wall space, then the modifier is plus 3 to each die, and destruction and fourth modifiers are not applicable. The same plus 3 modifier applies when we have an attack from two adjacent row 2 spaces. The next action is reward attacks, which is not an attack itself. The player spends one action point and one money to the supply in order to boost his attacks. This boost is plus 2 modifier to all players' attacks in the current action turn. And this modifier is on top of all the other modifiers explained earlier. Next, we have the support area action. The player spends 2 action points and increases his support in one of the areas. Player chooses one of the areas, and if that area is under his control, then he adds one more support marker to the area. Please note that all areas can hold a maximum of 5 support markers and no more. If he chooses an area under his opponent's control that has support markers on, then he removes one of the support markers. And if he chooses an opponent control area that has no markers on, he simply flips the area and takes it to his control. Players will receive the bonuses depicted on the areas they control later on every turn. Next we have the action Plea for Funds from the High Port. It costs 3 action points, it is connected to this track, and the player performs it to attempt to get some additional money. The player gets the 2d6 dice and rolls them. In order to be successful, the sum of the dice plus the value below his marker has to be less than 12. If so, the player gains 3 money and also increases this marker by 2 spaces. This automatically makes the next attempt harder. If the roll was a failure, player will not get the money, but also he will not move his marker. Next action, place cannons. If the player has an available cannon in his camp, he may place it on any space of rows 4, 5 or 6, paying a cost of 7, 5 or 3 action points respectively. The player takes the cannon from his camp and places it on a space that has at least one Imperial unit and no other cannon. The last Imperial action is preparation and is connected to this track here. Practically, the player stores action points he doesn't wish to use on his current turn by moving his marker on this track one space for each action point stored. The player could also store all his action points if he doesn't wish to perform any other action. Be careful! The player may use these points on any action on a future turn if on that turn he plays a card that doesn't have enough points to perform the specific action. Let's make an example. Let's say the Imperial player plays this card for the 3 action points to perform actions. If he wishes to build a cannon on row 6, this action costs 3 action points, so this card has enough action points and he may not use action points from the preparation track. This means he could not do a movement first and then use one more action point from the preparation track and build a cannon here. But if the player wants to build a cannon on row 5, which costs 5 action points, not only the player can use 2 of his preparation track action points to do the action, but also he could do a movement first and then use 3 action points from his preparation track. Let's move to insurgent actions now, starting with the regroup action. Regroup works the same as in the opening phase. In the action phase, the player pays 1 action point for each regroup he performs and picks up any of his units and moves it on any space the insurgents may exist, which is any space on row 2, 3 or the islands. Remember the placement limitations we already explained and just move any one of your units to any other space. Let's go to the insurgents' attack action. The action costs 1 action point and is an attempt to destroy an Imperial unit on an adjacent space. Attacks can be made from rows 2 or 3, but also from the island spaces. A main difference is that insurgent units may attack multiple times on a turn and not just once like the Imperials. The player rolls 1d8 dice and a roll of 6 or more is a success and removes the enemy unit. If that was the last unit in the space, the insurgent player may increase his morale or decrease the opponent's morale by 1 point. If the roll is a failure, as it happens now, then nothing happens. If the defender unit is on a space on a wall or a space on the beach, then there is a plus one modifier for the attack, and that is the only modifier on the insurgent attacks. Insurgents have another type of attack which is called raid, and it is used to attack enemy units that are further down in the mainland, meaning enemy units on any space on a row 5, 6, 7 or 8. The action point cost of raid is the distance between the raiding unit and the defending unit. The distance is the number of spaces the raiding unit must travel, hypothetically of course, in order to reach the defending unit. The path must be clear of enemy units. These insurgent units here cannot raid because they are blocked from enemy units. In this example, the cost is 5 action points and the player rolls a d8 dice and succeeds with a result of 5 or more. If the raid removes the last unit, remember to do the morale adjustments. The insurgents may also raid an Imperial unit in the outer space outside the island of Klisova, if they control the island of course, and if they are not blocked by another Imperial unit in the inner space. This raid costs 2 action points. The insurgents may also repair their walls. The player pays 4 action points and chooses one of the wall spaces that has a damage token and at least one of his units. If the space is destroyed, the player flips the damage token to the other side, indicating that the wall space is now damaged. If the space was only damaged, then the player removes the token. The insurgents may also train a civilian in fighting with 4 action points. The player removes one of his civilian cubes from Messolonghi and places a new unit to any space the insurgents may exist, meaning spaces on rows 2, 3 or the islands. The insurgents may also build a new cannon from the supply to any space of row 2, 3 or an island, provided there is at least one insurgent unit in the area and no other cannon. The action costs 4 action points and the supply token. The insurgents may also perform a support area action. Again, it costs 2 action points and works exactly the same as the Imperial support area action. Next, we have the pressure the government for help action, which is connected to this track. As we will see a bit later, at the end of each round a roll is being made to check if the government helps the insurgents by sending them some resources. With this action, the player pays 3 action points and moves his marker on this track by 1 space, increasing his chances for that roll. The insurgent player also has a preparation action to help him store action points he doesn't wish to perform on this turn. The action works exactly the same like the preparation action of the Imperial player. The action phase is over after each player has played 7 cards, so each player should keep 1 card for the next round. However, if the last card played contains an opponent's event, then the other player has the opportunity to execute this event by discarding his last card. In the cannon phase, both players' cannons fire, starting with the Imperial player's cannons. The Imperial player fires all his cannons one after the other in any order, provided there is at least one Imperial or allied unit in the space, otherwise the cannon doesn't fire. The player designates which cannon is firing, the target area, and rolls 2d6 dice and checks each die result independently. So each cannon firing could do a maximum of 2 hits. A cannon firing from this row can target any one of these 2 areas, and each die hits on a 4 or greater result, indicated from the number of the row as well. A cannon firing from the next row can hit any one of those 3 areas on a 5 plus result, and cannons firing from the last row can target any one of these 4 areas and hit on a 6 plus. Allied units are better with cannons, and when they fire them, they get a plus 1 modifier on the result of each die. A hit on an undamaged wall would damage it, and if it was already damaged, then it would destroy the wall. When a wall is destroyed, the Imperial player increases his morale or decreases his opponent's morale by 1 point. A hit on a destroyed wall would remove 1 insurgent unit. Finally, a hit on a destroyed wall with no insurgent units and just a cannon destroys that cannon. Likewise, the insurgent player fires all his cannons, provided there is a unit in the space to fire it. The cannon may target any area in the range I show you in the graphics, and the targeted row number indicates the required minimum die result to inflict a hit. The bombard cannon can fire at a greater range and has a plus 1 modifier on the result of each die. A cannon on a walled space may fire at an adjacent wall space. Each die roll of 4 or higher causes a hit. Cannons in the islands may target one of their surrounding areas, inflicting a hit on a die result that I'm showing you on the graphics. A cannon firing from the island of Marmaru may also target these 5 mainland areas and inflicts one hit on its die result of 6+, as indicated here. An insurgent cannon's hit removes an enemy unit or a cannon if it was alone in the area. Don't forget to apply the morale changes whenever the last unit is removed from the area. In the replenishment phase, players receive bonuses from the areas they control, but they also must pay resources to sustain their armies. The area bonuses are gaining morale or supplies, or even gaining units and cannons, which the Imperial player places in his camp, while the insurgent player places them in rows 2, 3 and the islands as normal. Exception: the 3 bonus units granted for controlling the sea area are placed in the surrounding area of Vasiladi Island from the supply. In the replenishment phase, the Imperial player executes the following steps in this order. First of all, he gains all the bonuses from the areas he controls. Then he must pay 4 money and 8 resources, which in the second period is increased to 6 money and 12 resources. If he cannot pay the money cost, he must lose a fixed amount of 2 morale. And also, for each money he's short, he must remove a unit from the map. And if they cannot pay the supplies, then they lose the difference in morale. Please note that if the Imperial player goes too low in morale, he might have to lose some additional units from the map, as it is depicted here. The insurgent player at first counts all his units and his citizens. And then they set the new population level by moving this marker. After that, they receive the bonuses from the areas they control. Then they have to pay supplies according to their population level. If they don't have enough supplies, then they lose the difference in morale. And finally, the player executes the pressure the government for help roll. The 2d6 dice are rolled, and to the total we also add the value below the player's marker on the pressure track. If the result was 12 or higher, then the plea is successful. The player gains 6 supplies, plus 2 in his morale, and also 2 units to place them in rows 2, 3 of the islands. Help from government is a one-time bonus. If ever successful, remove the marker from the board and you cannot roll for help again for the rest of the game. If, however, the roll was unsuccessful, like it is now, just forward the marker one space. When we enter the second period, a number of things happen except from changing the deck of cards. First of all, we have Egyptian units coming into the game on the side of Imperial expeditionary units. The Imperial player receives 10 allied units, which he must place on any space on rows 6, 7 or 8. Keep in mind that allied units and expeditionary units may never coexist on the same space. If the player cannot place all his allied units on the map, then he places them in the camp. Then the player receives another 5 units, which he places them in the camp. Then the player receives 4 immediate free support actions at sea. Finally, the Imperial player gains 6 supplies and 8 money. The insurgent player gains 10 civilian cubes, which he places in the city of Messolonghi, and forwards his marker on the pressure track by 1 space. And this brings us to the end of today's video of the very thematic Freedom from Vangelis Bagiartakis. If you liked that video and want to see more, subscribe to our channel. And until next time, have fun and play more board games.